morning, I share with you a poem to start out with this morning. Try to find yourself in this. It's called Why I Wake Early. Hello, sun in my face. Hello, you who wake the morning and spread it over the fields, into the faces of the tulips and the nodding morning glories, and into the windows even of the miserable and harsh. Best creature that ever was, not beneath the stars, dear star, that just happens to be where you are in the universe to keep us from ever darkness, to ease us with warm touching, to hold us in the great hands of light. Good morning, good morning, good morning.
Good morning.
Watch now how I start the day in happiness and kindness. Dear God, we gather together this morning in this place in awe of the beauty that surrounds us. We come happy this morning with a kindness in our hearts. Just so you know, we will have our mass up. We'll try to stay away from you a bit, but we will have our mass up so you can hear us. Our microphones aren't working this morning. It'll be like this morning. We're going to be referring to that as we sing this morning, just as you know.
praises to the beloved, all you saints. Give you thanks for love's holy name. Love withdraws when we close our hearts, yet ever awaits an open door.
My soul rejoices and is glad in you. Songs of gratitude fill my soul, rising up to you, O Lord.
You can turn in your packet and we'll do our adoration and praise. And you can stand if you'd like.
You can remain seated or stand whichever you like. We'll start out with morning as we're broken.
Building on my
might linger a while afterwards. There's wonderful paths that go all around here. The lake is down here. There's three huge beaches, places where you can walk along this wonderful path that goes right along the shoreline down here. Comes all the way around over here. So I just hope you'll spend some time, if you wore your outdoor shoes, and just walk around, even just up the top here around the green and all this. Absolutely beautiful. You can't help but feel that you are in God's presence and in awe of this place. I was walking the grounds earlier this week, trying to really enter into the spirit of this place. Linda and I used to walk here every Saturday morning. Last time I was here, my grandson was throwing rocks into the water out here. And so I have found a couple of wonderful poems. The first one I'm going to read, and then Paul's going to share the second. It's called Endless Ripples. It's by Joan Staple. Like a pebble dropped casually into a pond, so your words to a child will be. For endless ripples from them form, making circles beyond those you see. The tiny reed at the edge of the shore is rustled and moved by a wave, though it never was touched by the pebble you dropped, and you never a thought to it gave. Thus your words will touch others that you never see, as a child repeats what she's heard. And you never can tell whom the ripple will touch years after you've uttered the words. Choose your ripples with greatest of care, my friend, and consider the place where they fall. For the little pond you drop them in reflects you most of all. And Paul's got a follow-up that I thought was wonderful.
A single act of kindness, like a stone thrown in a pond, sends rings of ripples outward that travel far beyond. And joining other ripples flow upward to the sea. A single act of kindness affects eternity.
It's often called the ripple effect, a circle of love that begins with you and ripples out, right? Isn't that wonderful? I love that image. It starts with you, it starts with me, it starts with us. This is why we gather at least once a week, to be reminded of that, don't we? It's why we enter in so we can be lifted up again to be that ripple as we go out from our time of worship together. In our tradition at Moultonboro United Methodist Churches, we also share, where have you been affected by a ripple this week? We often say, where have you seen Christ? You know, has a ripple touched you this week, or have you been able to be able to sue?
I'd like to thank everybody that has called me, wished me well, dropped off chicken soup, dropped off a meatloaf meal that fed me 4 extra days. Sent cards for my birthday and for recuperation, and then sent me a beautiful bouquet of flowers last Sunday that still looks as good as it did last Sunday on the altar. And they sent happy birthday to Susan Scott, so. Many ripples.
Glad you're back with us, Sue. And a reminder, Sue is one of those that isn't that 5% that COVID's still real, and she had it pretty badly. And I heard you quoted as saying, I can't imagine what it would be like if I didn't have both my shots, too, right? It was pretty bad for Sue, yeah, so.
You have no energy.
Yeah. Well, it's a blessing to be able to be one of those little rocks in the pond that ripple out and touch someone. So it's been a blessing to hold you up in our thoughts and prayers. Anyone else? Bernadette. I think I recognize you. That is you there,
isn't it? My niece just had her baby.
Bernadette, you could pull that down here to speaking. Yeah, so.
My niece just had her baby, who is not due until January and the thoughts and the prayers that she is getting. This little girl is doing wonderful. And my niece got to hold her for the first time yesterday, and she was born on the 25th.
Bernadette, can you tell us your niece's name?
Destiny.
Destiny?
Yeah.
Destiny and the baby? Is the baby got been named?
Yeah, I'm not sure if you pronounce it Mercy.
Mercy? Oh, we'll use that word for now. Let's just take a moment to be in prayer. Now, for me, when I hear something like this, I just want to stop and connect to that spirit that has energy and just radiates out like a ripple. Let us be in a prayer for Destiny and Mercy this morning, giving thanks for hospitals and doctors and nurses who are there, especially in times when we need it most, with God's presence, God's love, incredible knowledge and ability, and the compassion to put it to use. Oh Lord, we pray that you'll continue to strengthen Destiny and that you continue to nurture Mercy, that it might bring you glory in this world, that they would be two new ripples that just go out to all extremes of our world in witness to you and what your tender love can do. Amen?
Amen.
Anyone else? Who else has a ripple? I'm thankful this week my son's been here because we are celebrating life with my mother later on this afternoon over at Claremont, and I have my two sisters who came over to be with and worship with. Can you just Dad and Kim, those are my two sisters from Claremont. So that's just wow, warms my heart to have family around and all. It's a real blessing. Anyone else?
Well, not as grand as this sound, but we were out to see our granddaughters this week, and it was just wonderful. One started to college, and she was so excited to see her excitement to show us around the campus, and the other one was a volleyball. To see a year of excitement was just so wonderful, so refreshing.
Actually, we don't have to compare ripples. They're all important, right? They're all, you know, special. Sure. Thank you for sharing that one, dude.
I was so sad when I came home.
Can you just drop that?
Oh, sure.
Just so we can have.
And I came home, and my lawnmower has been broke, so the grass has been like this. I came home, the whole front yard was moved. The whole black back was cleaned up. Maureen and your husband, thank you so much.
Amen. You talk about the Holy Spirit working. You know, with Maureen and well, the Spirit works with those people. Not that it doesn't work with us, but praise be to God. People like that.
Amen. Amen. Be able to be that stone that just drops in and touches someone. The bush hog angel, right?
With our trip to New York to see some of our kids and families and just being with them and telling stories. We all had such a great time. But the laughter, you know, we're in this restaurant. I think we just, you know, when we pulled down the ceiling, the laughter. But it was such a blessing being away from them, after being away from them for almost 2 years, be back together.
Be back together as family, especially after that long of time. Wow, that's quite a blessing. Well, let's take a moment to just be in silent prayer to give thanks for being able to be that ripple or to be touched by a ripple where Christ's love has been in someone and you felt it or you've been able to be that. Let's just also be in prayer for those in need, those who are on your hearts and minds this morning. thanks for being together this morning in this place. And we look here to the center and think of this like the pebble that's been dropped, and you're the ripples. Christ in the center. Christ at the center with us this morning. Remembering that Jesus took bread. First he gave thanks. He gave thanks even though he knew it was coming. And he broke it and he gave it to the disciples and said, take and eat, all of you. Do this in remembrance of me. Last month we talked about this as a symbol of taking a bite of Christ, where Christ is the way, the truth, and the life, right? The way of Christ. Will you bite into that for a moment? Taste that. And then to decide, do you want to be one with Christ? Do you want to actually drink the blood or mix your blood with the blood of Christ, that you would be one, right? Last month we talked about being blood brothers, blood sisters. We have tasted that, that's why we're here, right? We've seen that drop into the pond. We've felt the ripple. So we come together this morning and hear Jesus say that this is my blood poured out for you. The blood of the new and everlasting covenant. Well, covenant means relationship, right? It's about the relationship. And he said, drink from this often in remembrance of me. And so we linger a moment. And we do remember the ripples. We think about the life of Christ. And the life of the Jewish people and the renewal that had to come at that time. That's why God sends Jesus into the world to be the very presence, the personification of the way of God, right? To really show what love looks like. To show what God incarnate looks like among us, that we would be part of that. And Jesus goes the whole way in his ministry. Gives his very life that we might understand that and enter into that. So, Lord, we ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit once again on us gathered here together and on these gifts of the body and the blood, which we eat and which we take in as a blood transfusion. Make us one with Christ, one in ministry to all the world, until your way, your love, your compassion, your ways of forgiveness become the ways of all the world. All honor and glory is yours now and forever. And so we join together with one voice, one heart, praying the way that Jesus taught us, saying, Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And let us not fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And invite Mary to come up this morning. You to remain seated. We're going to come around to us, kind of pull your feet back a little bit. We'll come walk around, we'll serve you so you don't have to. seems so simple, bread and grape juice, and yet when we take it in, we actually feel your very presence, a blessing to us, a ripple through the ages that continues even today. Thank you for your presence among us, and we pledge, O Lord, to go out from here and take this with us. Take your way and take the relationship with you out to others. And all God's people said, amen. We're going to continue in our worship by presentation of our tithes and offerings. I'm going to just place them, start them on each side. If you just pass them around and pass them out behind you, that would be wonderful. And we'll pick them up as we're done.
Oh,
The lesson today comes from kind of a litany of readings. We're going to share those with you. Rebuild, renew, rejoice. That's our theme right now going into 2022. Today, as the ripples wash over us and out from us, we linger in the building and rebuilding part of that. It's not surprising that we hear the call to rebuild. It's always been a necessity for the faithful. The temple has been built and rebuilt several times over the course of history. So we turn to Holy Scripture then for guidance and inspiration.
The first Jewish temple built by King Solomon was destroyed by the Babylonian invasion of 586 BC. Later, according to Ezra, in the first year of King Cyrus of Persia, 538 BC, after conquering the Babylonians and liberating the Jews from captivity, the Lord stirred up the spirit of King Cyrus, so that he sent a herald throughout all his kingdom declaring, "Thus says King Cyrus of Persia, the Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has charged me to rebuild him a house at Jerusalem in Judah. Any of those among you who are of his people, may their God be with them, are now permitted to go up to Jerusalem in Judah and rebuild the house of the Lord, the God of Israel. And let all survivors, in whatever place they reside, be assisted by the people with silver and gold, with goods and with animals, in addition to free will offerings."
Of course, that second temple was destroyed in 70 AD by the Romans, when rebel Jews rose up against their rule in Jerusalem. Jesus and the Gospels speak to this destruction, but also to the underlying need to renew and rebuild the spirit and faith of the people, which had begun to unite as the body of Christ. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do you see these giant buildings? Not a stone will be left here upon another. All will be torn down." But he said to the religious leaders, "Tear down this temple, and in 3 days, I'll put it back together." But here, he was talking about the temple of his body, according to John chapter 2, 19 and 21.
Jesus also preached on the cost of rebuilding, especially the cost of being a disciple of Christ. He said to his disciples, "For which of you, intending to build a tower, does not first sit down and estimate the cost to see whether he has enough to complete it? Otherwise, when he has laid a foundation and is not able to finish, all who see it will begin to ridicule him, saying, 'This fellow began to build and was not able to finish.'"
The 5th century Greek philosopher Heraclitus said, "The only thing constant in life is constant change." Charles Darwin said, "It is not the strongest species that survives, nor the most intelligent. What survives is the one that is most adaptable to change." Change happens, right? All the time. Unless this building that we're in right here today is constantly kept up, it will change too, right? It will rot and it will eventually collapse, won't it? It's the way of all life. Back in the 1800s, this center actually started out as a dairy farm. And change came when it was purchased in 1889 by a son of Dr. Reuben Green of New York City and became Rockmount Poultry Farm, which was quite successful, actually. 7 years later, change was in the air again as tourism started to take off in the Lakes region and began to grow, and this farm was converted then into an inn, which is that big gray building that you passed as you drove in right beside us here. Change came about again in 1919. It was a fallout of World War I where tourism basically halted all around. And so this 200 plus acre facility, along with its nearly 1,000 feet of shoreline, was sold for $30,000 to the International Sunday School Association and became known as Geneva Point. The eastern site of the association's boys and girls camps around the country. Change came again in 1950 when the association became a division of the National Council of Churches. And finally, in 1986, a nonprofit was formed to take ownership and manage this facility as Geneva Point Center Incorporated. Change happens, always. Either change or rot away. So it's no surprise then that change is also necessary to the church, don't you think? As everything else is changing around, why should we think that the church shouldn't change and yet still survive? What worked 50 years ago generally won't work today, not without some change, some renewal, some rebuilding. A couple of years ago, a board member received a vision for the then rotting barn that is at the end of the green here. When you outside later, you look to the left. That's the barn that's on the front of your bulletins. It was rotting and ready to collapse. Let it continue to deteriorate and fall in, or renew it. The vision was to turn that into a place for spiritual gatherings, music, dancing. A venue they thought that we did some work on and rebuilt, renewed, could last another century or two. Change it or lose it, rebuild, refurbish, or see it eventually just collapse. So specific, measurable, and timely goals were formulated for the vision. Tear down the old side garage and rebuild it. Remove encroaching trees. Regrade for better drainage. Level and put in a new floor. A new roof was a must. And new siding to protect against the harsh winter weather of New Hampshire. And make it ready for 2022. In January 2020, the board of directors committed $120,000 for the project and began an initiative to raise another $85,000. Geneva Point Center friends and neighbors immediately responded and they committed $50,000 right off for renewal and rebuilding. Change or rot away. Rebuild, renew, rejoice, or collapse. Jesus' mission was a mission of change, was it not? To renew and rebuild the temple. But not a building, as you heard, right? It wasn't about a building. His vision was about a renewal of community and of the faith of that community. To bring forth a people seeking to live in the ways of a God of compassion. A God of peace. A God of unity and diversity. In the ways of forgiveness. In the ways of lasting joy, even in the midst of constant change. Remember what Jesus said. Take up your cross and follow me. To take hold of the vision for a gentler, kinder world, but a vision that would come at a price. Namely, his own life, right? And also a commitment then to change from those around and a commitment not only for the present, but for the future also. And so it's still the same vision for us today, though it needs to come about differently than the way it was pursued in the first century. A different way for a changing time, for a constantly changing time, for a changed time today, right? If you look at our hymnal, you would find a 1969 hymn by Fred Pratt Green. It says this, 1969, "The Church of Christ in every age, beset by change but spirit-led, must claim and test its heritage and keep on rising from the dead." Change or collapse. Change or die and remain dead. I'm moved by the words of Mahatma Gandhi, who said, "Be the change you want to see in the world, or if you can't change, then either get out of the way of the person who wants to be that change, or support the individual with your financial resources." And Jesus saw the need for change, and Jesus was the change, wasn't he? "I am the way, the truth, and the life. Be in me, I will be in you, and you will be the change." But he also recognized the need for financial commitment, saying, "Which of you, intending to build or to renew something, doesn't first sit down and estimate the cost to see if you have enough to complete the project?" Cool. Jesus was spirit-led, but he also probably would have been a really good businessman, don't you think? He knew how to balance the two. As should we. We recognize the need for change. A vision for 2020 is beginning to take shape. We've been talking about that, right? Kate Wilder has been, and others have been working on getting input from you all and starting to form that vision, right? Exciting plans are starting to come together. There is excitement in the air. Do I hear an amen?
Amen.
Yeah, there really is. I feel it. I see it all around. And we've got some pretty good estimates already on the cost to pursue some of these opportunities. Now we need to do what Jesus called for, to estimate our financial resources that we will commit to the vision, to the renewal and the rebuilding for the centuries to come. How much will we have in 2022? What plans can we step out on? A new accompanist? A youth leader? A spiritual renewal program, resources for small groups, a new outreach and witness initiative. You name the one you're thinking of. You name the one that you've been sharing with the group. This is why we pledge. So we can see what we are going to be able to complete of God's plans. Right? So it's good business. A lot of churches don't like the pledge time. They don't like to ask for money. We're not asking for money. What we're all doing is coming together and saying, we all feel the Spirit move, and we're all looking for, how are we going to commit to it? What is it that we want to see happen? And therefore, how are we going to get behind it? With our time, our talents, our prayers, our witness, and our finances, right? That's why they come. We're not afraid of it. It's what's reasonable to be doing. We're saying to God, we're behind what you're calling us to be all about. And so I think about that poem that we read earlier. "Choose your pebbles with greatest of care, my friend, and consider the place where they fall. For the little pond you drop them in reflects you most clearly of all." And I would add, reflects your God most clearly. Let us take a moment to consider the pebble that we're going to drop in the pond for God. Think about those endless ripples that are going to travel out beyond even our place, even beyond this circle, and affect others in our community, in our families, in our workplaces, and yes, in the world. One person changed the world. Think of it. We have that opportunity. ballots or pledge cards that I hope you have. Now, I know that some have already filled yours out, and actually have already turned them in. Thank the Lord. But I'm going to invite all of you to come up. I'm going to put a couple baskets up here where you can bring your pledge card up and put it there. I'm also going to bring up this box of blocks. This box of blocks actually makes a church when we're done. Pretty cool. So we're going to put the blocks up here. I'm going to move the communion plates underneath here.
Thank you.
going to live so. But it's such a wonderful response to what we're doing here. Let's rise and sing together. I'm going to live so God can use me. Pray, we're going to live. Pray, give.
Thank you.
Go and give thanks for the ripples that have brought you here, the ripples that have touched your life through the eons of ages and are still rippling around us. Go to be that ripple. Be blessed that you might be a blessing. And that would simply bring a lasting peace, hope, and joy to our world. Go in Christ, and Christ will go in you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much. I don't want to stop, dude. The table's open. Rejoice. Have something to eat.